early in World War II. The terrifying and highly effective U-boats of the Kriegsmarine had effectively created a maritime blockade in the Atlantic. Millions of dollars and countless lives were lost with every ship the Germans sent to the bottom of the ocean. The US and UK could no longer afford to lose any more vessels transporting valuable assets for the war effort. In their desperation to avoid more U-boat attacks, a unique proposal was considered by the US government: the use of flying boats. Billionaire aviator Howard Hughes would go on to create one of the biggest aircraft known to man. This Colossus had an astonishing wingspan of 320 feet and was equipped with 8 engines. It was baptized as the H-4 Hercules. Until recently, the plane with the largest wingspan in the world to ever fly. The Grey Wolves of the Atlantic. In the first half of 1942, the fleet of German U-boats in the Atlantic had been sinking more than 300,000 tons of Allied shipping every month. It was the equivalent of roughly 600 ships sent to the depths of the ocean at a rate of almost 100 a month. The US, with all of its industry and assets focused on armament, had neither the time nor resources to keep up with the tremendous rate at which the Axis was sinking its ships. A drastic solution was required to stop the permanent threat the U-boats posed to maritime supply routes. The RAF tried to bomb U-boat pens scattered across the Atlantic Wall and the Northern Sea, but it was futile. The RAF lacked the firepower to damage the thick concrete of the German bunkers. The Disney bomb, the only weapon with enough penetration capabilities to destroy German bunkers, would not arrive until the last few months of the war. Another idea had to surface to save U.S. ships from sinking. The U.S. War Production Board Committee had to come up with a solution. In the last days of May 1942, they thought it had arrived. An unconventional solution. On May 22nd, F.H. Hoag Jr., a member of the committee, proposed the use of massive flying boats. He mentioned to the board that if they could lighten the gross takeoff weight of current U.S. aircraft, the freed loading could be used for carrying supplies. Additionally, he pointed out, they could even save additional weight by not using landing gear, as flying boats did not require it. Industrialist Henry J. Kaiser, who specialized in Liberty ships, 10,000-ton freighters that he managed to build in just 48 days from the usual 355, proposed two compelling ideas to the board. Based on Hoag's idea, he suggested converting some of his shipyards to the mass production of giant seaplanes. His second proposal suggested creating anti-submarine aircraft carriers on his Liberty ship hulls. It was the idea of using flying boats to carry cargo on transatlantic journeys that won the hearts of the board members. A flying boat could safely cross the ocean, out of the reach of enemy torpedoes. In a public conference, he announced to his investors, quote, "Our engineers have planned on their drafting boards for gigantic flying ships beyond anything Jules Verne could ever have imagined." The massive flying boats soon grabbed national interest. In July, Kaiser had plans for producing the flying boats of 200 to 500 tons. He proposed that the Army and Air Force create models based on an enlarged version of the existing Martin JRM Mars design. Nonetheless, the Army and Navy considered his project unrealistic, although congressmen believed otherwise. Billionaire aviation aficionado. Kaiser was an ambitious and intelligent man. However, there was one problem with his ambitious plan. He knew about ships, but not about planes. Most aircraft companies were focused on the production of fighting aircraft and dismissed Kaiser without hesitation. They had no time for risky inventions. There was only one man in all the U.S. that had the money, time, and knowledge to lend him a hand with the project. That man was none other than billionaire businessman Howard Hughes. In August 1942, both men reached an agreement. Hughes would design the plane, and Kaiser would use the shipyards at his disposal to produce it. Development. In September 1942, the government awarded the two partners $18 million to produce 3 prototypes. However, some contract restrictions made the project even more difficult than first estimated. The biggest hitch was that they had to produce a working example in just 2 years. Most aircraft at the time took 4 years to bring to life. They also could not use strategic materials that the government feared would run scarce, such as aluminum. Additionally, The two partners were forbidden from hiring engineers and technicians already working for other aircraft companies. After 6 months of work, the extreme conditions the government imposed on the project forced Kaiser to quit. Hughes had to step in and take the entire project upon his shoulders. The first challenge Hughes had to overcome was the material that would be used. Engineers thought that using wood was impossible, but the genius of Hughes proved them wrong. He managed to develop a technique called Duramold. The process Hughes used consisted of, quote, crisscross layers of wafer-thin birch veneers bonded together with resins to create a strong and beautiful skin that required no rivets. The entire surface was sanded down by hand and finished with layers of rice paper and silver aluminum paint. Although the government later approved the use of additional materials, Hughes was reluctant to change the design, in which he worked hard to use as a substitute. Hughes opted for a design with a wingspan of 300 feet and a gross weight of roughly 400,000 pounds. His bold plan utilized 8 of the largest engines that were in development at that time. This was the maximum number of engines that seemed practical. It would make the Hercules, quote, the largest aircraft known to man. It truly honored Kaiser's reference to Jules Verne. The plane was from another world, almost twice as big as any other plane of its time. The Hercules design. People called the plane the Flying Lumberyard and the Spruce Goose. Hughes liked to call it the Flying Boat. A story goes that he also nicknamed it Jesus Christ, as those were the two words that came out of anyone who saw the gigantic ship for the first time. And that was with good reason. The final design, the HK-1, was gigantic. It had a wingspan of 320 feet, with a vertical fin 85 feet high. The weight was 100,000 pounds less than what Hughes estimated initially. The aircraft stood at 300,000 pounds. It was able to carry from 120 to 150,000 pounds of supplies. If used as a combat transport, the HK-1 could also carry 700 combat-ready troops or two American Sherman tanks that weighed more than 60 tons together. The 8 engines had 17-foot propellers and could generate just over 3,000 horsepower each. On paper, the Hercules had a range of 3,000 miles at a speed of 200 miles per hour. The two decks were united by a spiral staircase. The crew could easily communicate via intercom radio points without the need to abandon their posts. To keep the crew fresh, Hughes installed a pipe to supply fresh air. The Hercules did not suffer from the added weight of electrical cables, as Hughes created a specialized 120-volt DC electrical system that saved 75% of a conventional system's dead weight. An imminent cancellation. Although the Hercules was a never-before-seen colossus of engineering, development dragged on, consuming more money and time than any other project the U.S. Army was managing at the time. In March 1944, the War Production Board wanted to cancel the contract. With the war about to push into Europe and control of the Atlantic won back, the need for a giant cargo aircraft to transport supplies diminished. The board dispatched Grover Loening, a consultant to the board, to evaluate Hughes' work. He was still amazed by the project. In his report, he wrote that the Hercules was the most remarkable flying boat he had ever seen. Despite the efforts to cancel the project, administration officials renewed it. A one-time glorious flight. The war ended in 1945, but the Hercules project kept running. In 1947, a U.S. Senate committee investigated Hughes for contract irregularities. During testimony at the courtroom, Hughes stated, quote, "The Hercules was a monumental undertaking. It is the largest aircraft ever built. It is over 5 stories tall, with a wingspan longer than a football field. That's more than a city block. Now I put the sweat of my life into this thing. I have my reputation all rolled up in it, and I have stated several times that if it's a failure, I'll probably leave this country and never come back, and I mean it." On November 2, 1947, Hughes gave Senate members and other guests a taxi-run demonstration of his powerful plane. Hughes himself was the pilot. He was assisted by 6 flight engineers, 16 mechanics, and other crewmen. In the third run, Hughes surprised the guests and all the crowd gathered at the coast by lifting off the Hercules from the sea. The biggest aircraft known to man went airborne at 70 feet off the water with a speed of 135 miles per hour for 1 mile. From then on, none of his detractors dared to criticize him again. Hughes proved that his Colossus could fly. However, he pointed out that the Hercules was only a research aircraft. That is, quote, it would never be used in competition with military or commercial planes, but would help to deal with the problems of large aircraft. But it did more than that. Hughes' greatest achievement. It took more than 60 years to create a vehicle that could surpass the gigantic size of the Hercules. From 1947 to 2019, Hughes' airboat was, by some measures, the biggest aircraft ever constructed. It has since been surpassed by the scaled composite strato launch that has a wingspan of 385 feet. The HK-1 project was truly a Herculean task that immortalized both its legendary creator and its towering creation. The Hercules rests at the Evergreen Aviation Museum in McMinnville, Oregon.